Today, we're talking about box office revenue and if it's really as important to the financial success of a film as people seem to think. Believe it or not, almost all films fail at the box office. Once you break down the numbers, even movies that appeared to be massive hits like Spider-Man Homecoming are still technically in the red if you're purely going off of box office revenue. So if this is the case, how does the system manage to sustain itself? Now, the reason I think this is an important topic to discuss is that eventually I will get into film financing, but to really dive into financing, you have to understand how movies make their money back. Eventually, one day, you will be sitting across from an investor asking them to put money into your project, and you're going to be expected to answer questions and explain to them how their investment may eventually pay off, i.e. how that money may come back to them, and ideally with a little bit of profit behind it as well. So in order to do that, you really have to understand the flow of cash within this system. So all that and more to come in the future. If you're just joining us now, feel free to hit that subscribe button, press the bell for notifications so you don't miss a thing. Now, this is a very topical conversation to be having because right now around the world, most theaters and theater chains are closed, and there's a lot of speculation about what the future might hold for studios and for movie theaters moving forward. Along with that, Netflix has just announced its first $200 million production featuring Ryan Gosling and Chris Evans, slated to be shot in the coming year, called The Gray Man. Now, this is huge, 200 million bucks. Netflix has never put this much money in a production before. It's big for Netflix and it's big for the studio system as well. And they're anticipating taking that out with zero reliance on making money back through the box office system. So given these current events, are box office returns really that important to the future of film? And are we witnessing the end of cinema as a result of the global shutdown now that movies can't rely on earning those sweet box office dollars that they're used to bringing in? Well, pandemic or not, this seems to be a topic that pops up every couple of years, ever since the dawn of television. It seems people have been predicting the death of movie theaters. With home video release, with streaming, with the advancement of home television sets, people are always worried that eventually people are going to stop going out, cinemas will close, and that'll be the death of movies as we know it. And yet, through the years, this has never really happened. And while the industry has been hit because of this, it seems to have really only impacted and affected the middle class film, or the films with budgets between $20 and $60 million. However, and somewhat ironically, this slack seems to have been picked up by television and streaming entities that focus a little bit more attention on this level of production, this $20 to $60 million range. So even though these types of movies aren't being produced for theater anymore, they're still being produced. That's also why this $200 million budget announcement by Netflix is so interesting, because for the first time they are dipping their toe into the deep end, so we'll see how it goes. But for all the beatings that theatrical releases have taken over the years, they've never really gone away, and I don't think they ever will, pandemic or not, because their importance in the film industry has less to do with returning profits and more to do with marketing and creating marketplace relevancy for future channels of distribution. You see, before TV, home distribution, and streaming, yes, studios did rely 100% on box office returns to make their money. But now, Hollywood and the studios are in a much different business. Today, their business is all about creating rights and properties that can be licensed, whether it's for TV, streaming, video games, music, t-shirts, merchandise, whatever. And it's through these other avenues of distribution that the studios actually make their money. But yet, all we ever hear about is box office. Why is that? Well, partially it's through habit, through the Hollywood press, but it's also somewhat designed that way. You see, box office numbers are extremely deceiving, and in fact, all numbers in Hollywood are very deceiving. When you hear a movie cost $100 million to make, through things like foreign pre-sales, product placement, tax incentives, the hard cost of that film is actually well below that $100 million, but yet that $100 million is the only figure that's made obvious to the outside world. The same is true with most box office figures. When we hear that a movie cost $100 million to make and made $500 million domestically at the box office, we think, wow, you know, it's a huge hit, that's a huge success, and it is, but not necessarily a direct financial one. All that box office really tells us is the gross aggregate income of the various theater chains' ticket sales. So let's break this down. Let's say that a movie cost $100 million to make. Now, we're going to ignore those other outside sources of financing that may be affecting that number. We're just going to stick with $100 million. And let's say they spend $65 million in marketing. Now, again, a lot of times a movie's marketing and P&A is significantly higher than that, but that factors in other outside elements, other sort of external partnerships. For example, if a movie partnered up with McDonald's to print their label on cups, both parties are receiving advantages from that exposure. And so even though that goes on the books as a marketing cost, it really hasn't cost anybody anything. So going into theaters, our movie is already in the red for $165 million. And let's say our movie went on to make $500 million domestically at the box office, which is a huge number. That's a huge success. In 2019, only two movies made above $500 million domestically at the box office. So we did great, but again, that's just a gross number. So let's break this down even further. The theater's gonna keep 50% of that. So our 500 million is already down to 250 million. And the distribution company is gonna pay themselves back first for the marketing expenses they put into the release of this film. So that's another 65 million taken away. After that, our distribution company is gonna take their cut of the profits, which is on average about 25%. So right now we're only getting $138,750,000 back to the studio. We're gonna subtract the cost of production, 100 million. Now we're at 38.75 million. Now, a lot of times movies will have back-end points going to producers, directors, actors. We're just gonna cap that right now at about 10 million. So the studio ends up with 28.75 million, which is still a sweet chunk of change, but it is a far cry from the 500 million that was originally reported. And what seemed like a 500% return is actually only about a 28, 29% return. And this is from a smash hit. This scenario never happens. Like I said, in 2019, only two movies made over $500 million domestically, and both of those had budgets and marketing budgets well above the $165 million that we just gave in this hypothetical situation. So this is an outstanding runaway hit, never happens, and it only walks away with a 28% return, which is a very small profit margin for something this high risk. I want to emphasize just how much of a gamble this really is. Rarely do movies come back after the theatrical run in the black. The vast majority of them are still in the red at this point. And if this is the case, i.e. some of the worst odds possible at turning a profit, why are studios doing this? Why would they take that risk? Why would they put that much on the line, this type of numbers, for that low of a rate of return, that low of a profit margin, if at all? And if this is the case, how are studios actually making their money? If the odds of losing it are so high, and if most movies are failing at the box office, how are movies and studios actually making a profit? Because they are making a profit. The answer is in output deals and licensing agreements. These are the agreements made by TV cable companies, streamers, and foreign distributors who agree to purchase or license the entire slate of a studio's film every year. And this is a crucial part of Hollywood's cash flow that allows studios to remain in business. As I said before, studios are now in the business of creating rights and properties that can be leveraged, licensed, and sold. It's actually the unwinding of these output deals that will put the squeeze on a studio, not the dip in theatrical attendance. This is what happened in 2008 with New Line Cinema, who went out of business even though they'd produced massive box office hits like the Lord of the Rings trilogy. So if this is the case, if box office and theatrical releases are such a gamble and studios can't even rely on them as a source of revenue, what's the point in even doing it? What's the point in even releasing a film into theaters? The answer is creating relevance. It's marketing. It's the reason why we see such shallow numbers when it comes to what these films actually cost and what they actually earn. If a movie can brag about being number one or making back its budget in its opening weekend, people pay attention to that and it adds value to the property within the scope of popular culture, which sweetens the prospect of future output deals. When this occurs, newspapers love to report about it and studios love to brag about it. And in 2019, over $5 million was spent on average per title per instance that this occurred just so that studios could brag about being number one. But being number one at the box office doesn't necessarily mean being a financial hit. Most recently in 2020, during this lockdown, an independent horror film that was shot entirely over Zoom took advantage of the lockdown. They rented out a private theater and essentially bought $25,000 worth of tickets, making themselves officially the number one movie that week in the country. And at only $25,000 in revenue, it worked and you heard about it. This is the real value of box office. It creates marketplace relevancy. It's a massive marketing form that helps build the presence of the film into the popular culture before it enters the home video market, before it gets printed onto a t-shirt. And yes, there is a side benefit that possibly the money will be recouped off the top as well. But that's a side benefit because, like I said, that rarely happens. Adversely, a poor release will lower the general market value of the film as a licensable asset. But red at the box office doesn't mean red in the official books once merchandising and general licensing come into play. For this reason, I don't think studios will ever 100% abandon theatrical release, assuming that theaters can sustain themselves. And that is part of the bigger question here, but that's a question for another day. But I think especially when it comes to larger budget tentpole films, studios rely on this theatrical marketing to build the value into these larger films required to make them into licensable assets. So now what about foreign box office? Up to now we've really only discussed domestic, and the numbers seem to show that most films make the majority of their money through the foreign box office. Well, foreign box office is sort of an exaggeration of the loss and the gain of a title, and those numbers are even more murky. The added perceived revenue definitely adds to the hype of a title, but as far as actual returns, movies make significantly less once they enter the foreign box office because only about 25% of those profits make their way back to the studio, again, minus the cost of marketing. The real benefit of foreign outlets comes through pre-sales and output deals. The box office just sort of adds credibility. So for us indie filmmakers, our best bet is selling the film directly to a distribution company. Now, preferably a sale, not a licensing agreement, unless that licensing agreement comes with a good guarantee. But when speaking with financiers, it's best not to talk about theatrical profits because, as we've just learned, that can be very deceiving. But for the micro-budget film, self-theatrical distribution can be very lucrative, as the recent horror film produced on Zoom and others have proven to us. So you can bank on that a little bit, but understand that the true fortune of Hollywood doesn't really lie in theatrical distribution, at least not like it used to. Now, of course, there's exceptions to every rule, and every so often a film does come along that really destroys the box office and makes a lot of money back for the studio directly, but those stories are few and far between. But I think it's important to really have a good understanding of how this works and how money actually flows through films and through the studios and through different outlets of distribution. So that's it. Thanks so much, guys. If you got any questions, leave them in the comments below. If you enjoyed this video, please be sure to like, share, and subscribe, and we'll see you next time.